Who are we talking to?
Bill Dallman, Vice President of News, KCBS, and KCAL here in Los Angeles.
You're here tonight as a panelist to talk about state of the industry, some of the trends, some of the changes coming up. What have you noticed, and how long have you been in the business?
Well, I've been in the business 3 decades. I'm looking for, we're talking about millennials tonight, how to reach millennials. And I actually have millennials as children, and I don't know how to reach them. So I'm here trying to get some ideas and add my perspective.
Why is the millennial audience important, and do you think it's been overlooked over the years?
I don't think it's overlooked. I think it's the magic bullet that we don't have. I mean, you know, we've always had a situation where people growing up is our best ally, in that they grow up and then they watch television or they consume more media as they get older. But now with all these other telephones, apps, computers, internet, you know, it's become a much bigger battle.
How has the internet affected the television news business?
You know, the internet was supposed to kill us. It didn't. It grew. It made us stronger. The phone apps just might, though. I mean, the way you see the kids buried in their phone all day long, that's a tougher one.
Hey, what about trends in television news and news interviewing? We're seeing recently we had actor Sean Penn interview a drug lord. We saw Spike Lee interview a presidential candidate. How do you feel about that, and do you think that's ethical?
Well, I think everybody's trying to get into media, and they want to be producers. I mean, Kobe Bryant is going to leave basketball, but he's going to start a production company. You know, everybody wants a piece of that pie because they realize that that's where the influence is. That's where the, you know, that's where the creative comes from, is owning the company that creates the media. And so I think it's just a natural progression for some of the people that have been on that side of the camera their whole lives to want to be on the other side.
And I know you said media, not journalism.
Yeah.
It seems like they're cutting back on a lot of investigative reporters throughout the country and journalism. I talked to the guy, the movie is based on Spotlight, for example, the Globe. They got a Pulitzer Prize. And he said they're cutting back a lot on the investigative journalists and newsrooms, getting a pat on the back, but viewers are going to leave. How do you feel about your investigative unit at CBS? Are we going to see more of those kind of things, or are we going to see less?
We have a robust investigative unit led by David Goldstein, and we have consumer investigative as well. However, it's expensive to do. It doesn't turn every day, and you know it holds you open to lawsuits, and those are expensive. So I think only the bigger stations and companies can really afford to do great investigative journalism anymore, and some of the smaller markets are squeezed out, unfortunately. But I will say this, you know, many bloggers, many radio people, many magazine, they do it on their own. And that's what I would say to the aspiring journalist, is don't be afraid to do your own investigative journalism. If your company doesn't have a unit, go make one. You know, do it yourself. You can. And
is that going to be part of your message? What's your message tonight?
You know, I really am. I mean, I'm here to listen, but I think I have some ideas on how to reach millennials. I think our media being more positive, more conversational, relating to people on their level, as opposed to here's the news, we've brought
so
it down.
So more like engaging in social media.
Absolutely.
Which is very, very hot right now.
And it's all connected. I mean, we reach them on social, we get them to watch TV, we push them back to the Facebook page. I mean, all that is important, and that's stuff that will resonate with them, I hope.
One final question. You get a lot of stuff sent to you. Every TV station says, you know, whether it's whatever, Witness News, send your video. How do you vet that, and how hard is that? Because what if somebody sends you the, you know, a bogus video, like somebody standing in a river that's, you know, from a flood zone, and it's not really the same country?
True. I mean, you can get caught in that. There have been some of those unfortunate situations.
Breaking stories, for example.
Thankfully, I haven't been on the other end of it yet, but we try to vet it as best we can. We do have a team of assignment editors that goes through everything. There's another check that it goes through the edit coordinator, and he looks at it. If anybody's suspicious, we can all, you know, the digital technology is such that we can all call it up and look at it now off the server. So if it's suspicious, you know, we hope to catch it, but, you know, things do get by us. The other day, when the Trump rally was being held in Anaheim, there was a swear word clearly listenable on the tape, and luckily we caught it before it took air. But you know, that if we had rushed that process and we had just thrown it on the air, there would have been a problem.
That begs another final question. How do you control people? Because it seems like even the anchors on the networks are using more foul language. Donald Trump uses a lot of different languages, and it seems like it's being more common. What would you like to see? Would you like to see maybe a little tone down of that? Because it just seems like it's spreading more, and you got families watching television news too.
Yeah, true. I mean, I think we'll always do our part to be above the fray, but it's a cultural phenomenon. I mean, if you watch sports shows now, the live sports shows, you know, they stray into territories that you would have never heard from a network sports show prior.
Yeah.
So I think it's a societal issue. I think there's more tolerance for it. But at CBS, we just try to set a high bar and keep ourselves above it.
Now, what about high-speed chases? At one time, all the stations said, we're not going to do them anymore because they're taking over. Yeah,
one I wasn't
time. That's a good one. Anyway, 5 years ago, they all said, we're not going to do it anymore. And then all of a sudden, we're starting to see it again. What is the criteria for covering a high-speed chase? Is it traffic stall because a murder suspect? What are the criteria you're seeing as far as, I don't want to put you in a corner, but just what are all the stations cover?
I think what I use to choose the criteria, and we're a little different in that we have KCBS and KCAL.
Right.
And KCAL, we're much more likely to carry a chase because we're not a network affiliate. So we don't have a lot of programming. That we're going to go over. But I think what I tend to choose is if the person's going at a high rate of speed in traffic and being pursued, it's dangerous. And, you know, I feel like people want to know when there's a public danger. You know, if he's running in the middle of,
make it in the middle of the freeway, like Arizona.
Yeah, or if they're on, you know, some remote highway in the Death Valley, we're not going to follow it. But if it's going through Hollywood, you can bet we are.
Gotcha. Hey, thanks for talking, and have a good evening.
Thanks, George.